From the first seconds, we are shown all the horrors that the girls have experienced in reality. The girl is suspended from the ceiling by ropes with no ability to move her arms or legs in the middle of a dark room. The action shifts to the protagonist, Michelle Knight. She plays with her son Joey and prepares to go get a job. She promises her child that she will find a job and gives him to her mother to look after. The girl gets an interview at a laundromat, but fails because she couldn't finish school. When she arrives home, she sees her son playing with a bottle of alcohol, her mother is gone, and a drunken man is sleeping on the couch. The alcoholic wakes up and starts harassing the girl. The boy decides to stand up for his mother, but the huge boogeyman just throws him off. At the hospital, a nurse tells them that she found signs of abuse on the patient's body. They want to take the child to safety until the heroine can improve. She tearfully begs to keep her son. Michelle talks to a friend and tells her that they did take the boy away, but there is still a chance to change the court's mind. The heroine now lives at her cousin's house, and her friend's father comes to pick her up. In the next scene, the girl is about to go to court, but her mother calls her and tells her that she can't go with her. She decides to walk to court without knowing the address. Michelle wanders around town looking for the right building and enters a supermarket. It's half an hour before the court starts, but she meets a familiar man in the building. It's her friend's father, who offers to give her a ride in his car. She graciously agrees to Ariel Castro's offer. The driver offers to stop by the house to pick up a puppy as a gift for the boy. Though not immediately, the passenger agrees. They arrive at the man's house, whose backyard looks more like a junkyard. Ariel lives alone, so the house is a mess. They go inside and up to the second floor. The man takes his guest into the room and locks the door, then ties her up. She screams that she must report to court immediately, but the kidnapper cares little. The man pulls down his pants and confesses that he wants to have someone by his side after the divorce. He checks the ID and finds out she's only 21, then rips up the only picture of her son. The girl begs him to let her go, but gets kicked in the stomach. He covers her mouth and puts a gun to her face to scare her. They hang her from a wooden beam and leave the room. The captive tries to call for help from the people next door, but no one hears. The man goes out and leaves Michelle hanging. She was in this position for several days without being able to eat or go to the bathroom. Her mother went to the police for help, but officials believe the girl was simply afraid of responsibility. Meanwhile, Ariel comes to the prisoner for the purpose of feeding her. She refuses and asks only to be released. The man grabs her by the leg and drags her down the stairs to the basement. There are many sheets lying there, but which the villain rapes Michelle. They then tie her to a pole and give her money for her services. She recalls spending time with her son while she listens to the story that no one is looking for her. Everyone assumes the girl just ran away. The bastard binds the prisoner in chains and says he will do what he wants with her, after which he puts it on the girl's head. In the evening, the tyrant's mother arrives with food. The girl tries with all her might to call for help, freeing her hands and mouth, but the tyrant manages to get her mother off and downstairs in time. He immediately notices the sluggish restraints and praises the captive for learning. The villain tightens the tourniquet and is about to feed. Not immediately, but Michelle agrees to eat one forkful. The villain goes to his friends to play instruments with them and confesses that he is happier with having sex in his life. The heroine is once again raped and leaves many bruises on her body. The rapist tells her that he didn't mean to hurt her and that he used to get beaten up all the time by the man who was supposed to protect her. She takes her captor's hand and sues her, asking him to let her go. The villain agrees to let her out, but tricks her and locks her in a room again, where he nails up the windows. She dreams of playing with her son on Christmas Eve, when suddenly, Joey disappears and the girl is left alone. Much time passes, Christmas comes, and she is still a prisoner. Ariel brings the television to the girl. As time passes, summer arrives. One day, Michelle is singing in her room. The kidnapper decides to go to her and play the guitar. The girl sings about separation and returning to the man she loves. She asks her to write a song for him. The girl already had a song dedicated to the bastard, which she calls Concrete. It talks about a man no one has ever loved. She provokes the kidnapper, when suddenly, someone knocks on the house. It is the rapist's brother and his child who have arrived. The girl tries every possible way to signal, but Ariel cleverly gets out of every situation. The villain walks up to her and knocks her out with a punch to the jaw. Michelle imagines talking to the son she imagines in front of her. The villain walks into the room and beats her so she doesn't have to hear the conversations again. Another day, Ariel brings a puppy to the prisoner, much to her delight. After another rape, the villain forgets to latch the lock on the chains. This gives the girl the opportunity to go down to the first floor where Ariel is waiting. The whole thing was a test of loyalty, which the girl fails. He kills the puppy and complains he doesn't get enough love. One day, the villain brings in another girl. She tries to slip away, but receives several blows that render her unconscious. Amanda Berry is put on the wanted list. The news shows her mother asking for the girl back. Suddenly, the heroine becomes ill. She realizes what this is about. The villain brings a new prisoner into the room. It turns out that the girls once went to painting classes together. Ariel threatened that he would kill one of them if they do not communicate in his presence. He moves Michelle to another room and rapes Amanda. The heroine turns to her roommate and offers to come up with an escape plan, but she is too afraid of her kidnapper. 2 more months have passed since Amanda's kidnapping. She recalls happy moments with her son and sings songs to her unborn child. A villain enters the room to rape her and realizes his captive is pregnant. He is not going to tolerate children in his house and leaves the room. The girl is going to defend herself with a shiv hidden behind the TV. The bastard brings in a dumbbell and punches the girl in the stomach to get rid of the baby. At night, she has a miscarriage. The bastard takes the girl outside to help in the backyard. She puts on a wig and glasses, and outside, asks a neighbor for help, signaling to him. At the house, she tells Amanda that the police are coming for them. The girl hears the sound of the police from the street, but they came on another call. The girl is very upset because another chance to get out is gone. She pulls out a sharpened object and tries to open a vein, but remembers her child. She has a renewed incentive to live and fight the hardships. The child's birthday is coming up. A villain enters the room and orders him to drill a hole in the wall to run a chain through it. Police arrive in the neighborhood on a call from a woman who hears screams, which are quickly hushed, in the house with the captives. The news breaks about another missing girl, Gina De Jesus, who was on her way back from school. Ariel walks into the room and says he has brought them company. There is a battered girl standing in the kitchen. They have to cut each other's hair. There are alarms on all the doors, so there is no way to escape. Michelle says that now there is a chance to get out, because there are now 3 of them. Gina has been kidnapped in the same way as the heroine. The girl is a friend of the villain's daughter. Michelle says that they will definitely get out, and God will help them do so. From now on, they will be in the same room. The townspeople have organized a mourning party. The girl's parents were very sad about what had happened. Everyone who cared came to support them, including Ariel. He had the nerve to speak and hug the captive's mother and raise a candle for her. When he gets home, he turns on the girl's TV and shows them the news. The villain taunts Gina and insults the heroine because no one remembers her or looks for her. She pounces on the tyrant with her fists, but he only chuckles and rapes the girl, so Michelle can't reach her. In their room, they work out to fight back one day. The heroine is celebrating her son's 7th birthday. Her roommate is afraid of the future, but Michelle manages to calm the girl down. The news tells her that Amanda's mother has passed away from heart disease. In the next room, the prisoner cries at the top of her voice. The villain removes the prisoner's chains for good behavior. They sit at the same table, and Ariel tells them that Amanda is carrying the scum's child. Many months pass, and the girl is already in labor. The girls are brought in to help the girl in labor. The villain panics over the screams and turns on loud music. The baby comes into the world. It is a girl, but she is not breathing due to early labor. The timer puts a gun to Michelle's head and forces CPR. They manage to save the baby, who is taken away by the biological father without letting the mother take her for the first time. The girl turns 1 year old. As the years pass, the girl grows older, as does the heroine's son, who is now 14. The girl grows up not understanding that her father is a tyrant and a rapist. She thinks that Michelle is an art teacher. She is already losing hope for release. The villain is having trouble getting a job, so he may be deprived of his home. The girl complains that her aunts can't go outside to walk in the park with her. She starts screaming and annoying her biological father. He gets very angry and puts his hand over her mouth and orders her mother to shut the girl up. At night, the villain forces Michelle to dig a hole for the plants. She begins to taunt and provoke the fiend, but he fears that Jocelyn will grow up in such conditions and hate her father. The heroine suggests that he surrender in order to relieve the burden and receive a milder sentence. He is not ready to go for it because his family will find out about it. The villain didn't want to do Michelle any harm, but he couldn't help himself anyway and says that he's been through a lot. The heroine has a fever and is very weak. Ariel tells his daughter that he is going to her mother's house and will bring her groceries. He leaves, but doesn't close the door all the way. Jocelyn tells her mother about it. She opens the door and calls people for help, telling them her identity. The woman who arrives does not believe her words. The real Amanda Berea died long ago. The men break down the door and let the prisoners out into the open. In the room, the girls dance quietly until the police arrive. They enter the room with the prisoners and set them free. They don't immediately believe it. Gina comes out, and the police officer confesses that she was looking for a girl of 9. They are afraid Ariel will come and kill them, but the rescuer promises they will protect them. It's an incredibly touching moment when the heroine finally steps outside the house she's been in for 11 whole years. The light blinds her eyes. She falls to her knees and screams that she is finally returning to her son. The girls are brought to the hospital. Michelle refuses service to the men and only wants the girls by her side. The cops leave, and the head of the department reminds her of the man who told her for 11 years that the girl just got scared of the responsibility and ran away. She wakes up and sees her surroundings clean and lots of presents. The news broadcasts how the girls have been found by family, but the heroine doesn't even have anyone to call because everyone has forgotten her. Jake Solana, an FBI officer, walks in on her. He brings the girl some presents. For the first time in a long time, she eats something other than leftovers. He holds out a handkerchief to her, but she is very frightened, for she has had handkerchiefs put in her mouth before to shut her up. So far, they have not found her son. Her mother comes to see the heroine, but she doesn't want to see the one who abandoned the search at all. It turned out that the mother had packed her daughter's things and gone to Florida, and no one has ever lit a candle for her. For the first time in a while, she rinses all the dirt out of her hair and uses regular toothpaste and a toothbrush. They bring her glasses and turns on the news. A man stands meekly in court with his head down. She is released from the hospital and given a keepsake necklace. Jake takes her to a hotel. He promises he will give any news about her son and leaves. Michelle meets with Gina. The girls say she wants to live a normal life and wants to forget everything that has happened. In order to do that, she needs to stop communicating for a while. An FBI officer tells the heroine that Joey's guardians refuse to let the boy meet his biological mother. They even refuse to give him a picture to avoid contact with her altogether. But it is still possible to get the court to allow her to meet her son. Michelle wants to be alone for the time being, after which she begins to cry. Time passes and she gives her answer. She says she is willing to give up her son to keep him happy. Michelle is about to go to court and testify against the perpetrator. She goes to church and then to court, remembering all the insults in her direction along the way. She recounts her suffering in court. She wants her 11 years in prison back and wants him to sit in prison for the rest of his life. At the end, though, she is shown getting a picture of her son and thanking everyone who freed her from hell. Ariel Castro received 1,000 years in prison, but he hung himself in his cell a month after his sentencing. Today, Michelle lives her life to the fullest, and her book about her experiences have become bestsellers.
For 11 years, I'm finally being heard, and it's liberating.